they're particles that might be dark matter. And so that's what that experiment may tell us something about what this stuff in these small galaxies actually is. We do think we're measuring the masses of these very small objects correctly. These things are really interesting. We think we're seeing the limits of galaxy formation, that we're seeing the smallest galaxies that we know of, and in fact galaxies can't form much smaller, much fainter than that. And so these small objects, these ultra-faint dwarf galaxies, are giving us information both about how galaxies form and galaxy formation, and also giving us information about dark matter and how much there is and what it actually is. So that's really where my research has gotten us. So let's come back to this missing satellite problem, and I'll wrap up and take questions. So now we know of 24 galaxies around our Milky Way. And I was saying that simulations predict a few hundred. So that still seems rather different. We haven't actually searched the full sky for these new objects. So the Sloan Digital Sky Survey, in which all of these have been found, has so far mapped about a fifth of the sky. So just assuming that this, you know, everything's normal, and that if we continue searching the other four fifths, we find just as many galaxies as the parts that we've already searched, we predict that there should be something like 60 or 70 dwarf galaxies around the Milky Way. But that's not the full story, because the Sloan Sky Survey can only find the faintest galaxies out to a certain distance, because it doesn't go as deep as we want it to. And so if we do that correction and say, well, if we kept searching deeper, we probably would find the same number of objects, then we get numbers that are going up to about 200 or 300. And so that's getting a lot closer to the sort of several hundred that the predictions suggest. And so instead of having a missing satellite problem, we probably have a missing satellite mild annoyance, where the numbers actually seem like they may in fact line up. We may still have some need for dark galaxies that don't have any stars in them. But in fact, we think we are seeing most of the things that the predictions suggest, and that our understanding of galaxy formation in these numerical simulations, in fact, may be correct, and we can believe all the other results that are coming out of them. So in my next couple of years of research, we're going to continue looking for these other objects that we predict are probably there, is sort of one direction that we're going. The other direction is to continue doing follow-up and measuring more velocities for more stars and get their masses much more accurately, and also measure masses for the new things, hopefully, that we will find in the next couple of years. So I'll open it up for questions. Hopefully, you followed where I was going. Yeah?
Does dark matter continue to form, or did it all form at the time that they
got? That's a good question. So when did dark matter actually form? We think all of the matter that's in the universe formed with the Big Bang, so that all of the matter that's in the universe has always been there, and we don't create or destroy much matter. So we do think that all the dark matter that we expect to be in the present day universe has been there throughout the past.
So there's no interchange?
No. A tiny little bit. Some goes, you know, you can change matter into energy, but for the most part, the ratios have been rock solid and been stable throughout history.
I have one more question. So you can't define dark matter as non-radiating matter?
Yes, so the definition of dark matter is that it has gravity, it doesn't have radiation, so it doesn't produce light, and it also can't interact with normal matter in any way except for gravity.
So does a black hole constitute dark matter?
That's good. So black holes constitute dark matter because they don't, most of them don't give off light. There are other experiments suggest that this dark matter that we need in galaxies is not made up of black holes. And that's another talk.
You actually said something about matter and energy. So is there 90% is dark energy also?
Oh dear, I don't want to get to dark energy. So so E equals mc squared. So energy and matter are basically the same stuff, because there's an equation that you can go between the two. So if we look at the entire universe, the suggestion is that if everything adds up to 1, 70% of the energy density of the universe is dark energy, 30% is dark matter, 29% is dark matter, and 1% is everything else, so us. So when I say 90% of the matter in the universe is dark matter, I'm actually only talking about that 30% that's not dark energy. I'm not going to answer questions on dark energy.
When bound by the same laws of gravity that our matter is bound by, or are they different?
Yeah, so everything that has mass has gravity, and it's the same law of gravity. There are, you know, it's possible because we can only test gravity on the scales that we can measure. So, you know, in this room or out to the moon, there's been very exquisite tests of gravity out to the moon.
I realize regular gravitation is the same as the dark matter.
Mm-hmm.
Is G the same, actually?
So right now the assumption is that gravity is the same whether it's regular matter or dark matter. And there are suggestions that you could explain it if gravity was slightly different, but everything explodes at that point. You can't get a coherent theory of galaxy formation if you do that. So the assumption is that that if it's mass, and it doesn't matter what kind of mass, it has the same gravity, the same gravitational law that you did in physics. Class. It's the same law of gravity. Yeah.
So I think I lost something here a little bit. I've always understood that dark matter was extremely dense, and therefore the gravitational pull would be extremely strong.
So dark matter is just matter we can't see. And so there is, you know, in the center of a galaxy, it's denser, it's more dense. There's, you know, and that's mostly dark matter, so it's dense there. But in the outer parts of galaxies where things are less dense, dark matter does it can be low density or high density, it doesn't matter.
Okay,
it's
so
just particles that have certain amount of mass.
Okay, so dark matter is not exerting a gravitational pull on the galaxies in the universe?
It's exerting a gravitational pull in proportion to its mass, in the same way a star or a person exerts gravity in proportion to its mass. So it has there's nothing special about dark matter in terms of gravity. The amount of gravity is proportional to mass, and that's it.
Hey.
So could you ever feel dark matter? And the answer is not really, except if you felt its gravitational pull. Well, that's a good question. So the way we think of it right now, and I can't give you real evidence for it, but we think dark matter is just little particles, kind of like an electron or a proton, but just that doesn't interact with us. So in fact, there is dark matter in this room, and they're particles, but because they only interact with us in gravity, not anything else, we really can't tell the difference. So there are laboratory experiments that try and detect dark matter. And the idea is, occasionally a particle will come and bump into another atom, and you can see that, you can see the results of that. And the best experiments expect that to happen 3 or 4 times per year. They could, but there have to be a reason. They don't pull things without any sort of reason. So it's the same way you think about the planets in the solar system. The planets in the solar system are orbiting around, and they're not allowed to do anything else but orbit around. So dark matter has to follow gravity. It's not allowed to do anything else. So it can't do anything funky like come and attack you. Yeah.
Is there an evolutionary change in
Yeah, so whether or not like the proportion of dark matter and regular matter has changed. So, you know, in these sort of simulations, the universe from the Big Bang to now is constantly changing. So I would show you a movie at this point. Galaxies are forming and merging and interacting with each other, and it's a very, it's a real dynamic. And so, for example, our galaxy, you know, our galaxy is rotating, and it's the next largest galaxy is the Andromeda Galaxy, M31. And these two are neighbors. It's our closest large galaxy. And there's all these satellite galaxies around us. Eventually, the two big ones are going to merge together, and we'll all become one big, happy, huge family with lots of satellites around. So, and all this is in both the dark matter and in the stars.